Put your hand up if you know how to do that in the box. If you are a caregiver of parent or a caregiver of someone with autism or special needs, raise our hands. I am myself. Okay, great. A lot of us here. Okay. Fantastic. If you are a provider of someone, you know, treating individuals with autism, raise your hand. Okay. Yeah, and you can also just raise your hand like me. I can't find the button. I have too many things going on as the presenter, so great. If you are a grandparent or a sibling of someone with autism, raise your hand. Okay. And last, if you're a professional and a caregiver or a sibling, raise your hand if you have both. Yeah, me too. Me too. Great. All right. So I'm going to start today. My name is, as I said, Amy Kelly, and I am the National Director of Family Engagement at Devereux Advanced Behavioral Health. We are a large mental and behavioral health organization across the U.S. We're in 13 states, and we serve basically individuals with autism, intellectual and developmental disabilities, emotional behavior disorders, mental health issues, and then some other sort of acute care issues, as well as we provide school and community services and consulting services to many people. And I have the honor of working and representing our families. And part of that is because I'm also a mother to three now young adults. I keep saying three kids, but my oldest just turned 21, which is crazy to me. And then I have my daughter, Annie, who is 19. And Annie has severe autism, intellectual and developmental disabilities. She's minimally verbal. She has verbal apraxia, so it's really hard for her to talk. She didn't start talking till she was 10. And she has general anxiety disorder, among some other things. So she's a pretty complex little lady, wonderful, as you'll see. And so let me just get it over on my presentation. Everybody can still see my presentation, right? Great. All right, so I wanna talk to you today. I'm gonna be sharing the perspectives of what my experience with Annie has been and sort of generalizing some of those to you all to understand ways that we can help our families cope. We can help, if you're a clinician or a staff who works with families, ways we can better engage and trust each other and relate to each other. I have worked with thousands of families over the last 15 years doing what I do for Devereux, and also personally, just being there as an advocate and a resource. I will first state up front that my preference is to use person first or person-centered language over identity first language. And I say this because this is a pretty hot topic in the field right now, particularly in the autism community. So I want to start by talking about what that is in case people are not aware of what that is. For those of you, let me just ask real quick, if you remember that you put your hand up, if you can put your hands down, if you don't have a question right now, that would be great, just so I don't think there is a question going on. Cool. You guys are much more efficient at this than I am. All right. So person first language is language that puts a person before their diagnosis. So a person with a disability or a child with autism. I prefer this way as a parent. I always say my daughter who has autism. You will never hear me say my autistic daughter. Part of that is because she's never been able to say to me she identifies that way. So I always default to person first language. Identity first language is leading with a person's diagnosis. So you'd say, I'm a disabled person, or I'm an autistic person. And really there's no right or wrong to this. It's really about comfort and preference. And so I think anyone, you know, we all have to respect how we all speak about this. And if there's self-advocates on here, feel free to type it in the chat box, but many people who have the ability to be a self-advocate and identify that way prefer identity first language. I am going to be defaulting to person first language in this. back to the screen. There we go. So my goals for today are really to give you a sense of what families who live with individuals with mental and behavioral health needs or autism or really just chronic conditions that span through the lifespan, what we deal with every day. And obviously I see person first, excellent. So many parents prefer that. And I see many of you are parents, so you're gonna, and caregivers and grandparents, you're gonna really relate to a lot of what I say, I have a feeling today. I really want this to be interactive, as I said. And so let's use that chat box. But as we go, if there is, so Chanel, I think that's how you say your name. Your hand is up, and I'm not sure if you have a question. What I would ask is if your hand was up from identifying what at the beginning with, how you are here, go ahead and put your hand down. If you have a question, go ahead and come off mute real quick and you can ask me. Otherwise, what I'll do is I'm going to take breaks throughout our presentation and ask for questions. And I would love it first if you want to come off mute and ask it to the group, because I think, that's the way we make this interactive. We're all here to learn from each other and to exchange information. So I really, for those of you who wear both hats as a professional and a clinician, I want to help you to think outside of the box on how to work with families and be creative, and also to recognize our own mental models, which we'll talk about in a little bit, and then help with teaching some coping strategies for everyone involved. So clinicians and staff, our families, we all need to be able to cope. This is really intense work, and it's really intense being a family that lives with someone that has some extra special needs. Okay, so I'm gonna start with a video, and this one is the tricky one. I'm gonna have to switch screens because it's on YouTube. But I'm gonna give you it's a video that was developed about 10 years ago from my organization. This is not an advertisement for my organization, but it is a way to explain sort of what many families encounter. So let me go ahead and see if I can pull up that screen, and we'll start with that. Now, let's see, I have to get that over here. Can everybody see my screen? All right, let me make sure this volume is up. Let me move this thing. Sorry guys, hold on.
When you...
All right, let me move this to another screen.
Hear a stunning diagnosis about your...
I apologize. Hang on. I know you can probably see this too, so I have to figure out how to move this. Okay, that's one thing we don't need. Yes. Over here. And I don't know how to move this bar. Does anybody know how to move this bar?
We can't see it, I don't think.
Oh, you can't? That's fantastic. No. Oh, good. I'm so worried that you can't. Okay, you don't see where it says I'm screen sharing?
Nope.
Oh, fantastic. Great. Okay, here we go. I'll just rewind that and we'll start again.
When you hear a stunning diagnosis about your child, it's not what you hope for. It's not what you dream of.
I noticed there was something different about Sam almost immediately. He was pretty flat. His affect was flat. I was not a layperson when it came to autism.
We kept being encouraged by pediatricians and other medical professionals that it's okay, he'll get there.
David was in complete and utter denial. I hit the ground running and sought out every expert I could find.
But at some point, it becomes the new normal. You realize he's going to bring us love and he's going to bring us joy and he's going to have achievements in his life.
Perhaps it's a bit dramatic for me to say that Devereux saved my family. But we were a fractured family. You certainly can't imagine it unless you're living it. You just can't.
front of the secretary. We're trying to control Justin. And the girl behind the desk said, let him go. There's nothing here that's going to, hurt him. There's nothing here that he's going to hurt. And this is Devereux. We're ready for him. Justin became a resident of Devereux at 9 years old. When he's not home, we miss him. At 32 years, great kid. He is just a very happy, happy individual. And he'll make you laugh.
Annie was about 15 months when we started the early intervention process. The day before she turned 2, she was given the diagnosis of autism.
You're looking at what feels like a lifetime of uncertainty.
I assumed Annie was going to be my best friend. And guess what? She is, but it's a very different picture than what I thought. I had to mourn the death of the daughter that I thought I would have, and then I could accept the daughter that I do have.
You need to make sure they have a system of care that kind of wraps itself around the needs of the family.
And I went to Devereux Cares. I really was touched by the way that they embraced Annie as an individual and didn't lump her into one size fits all kind of program. I would be able to breathe when she went to school. And I didn't find that anywhere else. If Annie wasn't at Devereux, I don't know where we would be today. And I don't know that she would be where she is.
What Devereux? Because Devereux is in our own backyard. It's 100 years old. And for 100 years, they have provided scrupulous, loving, nurturing care to the most vulnerable members of our society.
There aren't a lot of organizations that change lives fundamentally and at the same time shape the larger society as a whole.
All right, so let me go back to our other screen. This one. Can you guys see the other screen now? Yes, you can. We're back at the presentation or no? Oh, hold on. There we go. Okay, sorry, I knew that was going to happen. It would roll right in. Okay, so I'm just having trouble seeing you guys. Let's stop there. One second to put this on the correct. There we go. Okay. So we're back. You can see my screen, right? Is that correct? Yeah. Thank you. I just need a little bit of input. Cool. Okay. So, you know, I think what that video does is capture what many, many families go through, particularly when you have a more severely impaired child, like my own daughter. We know that autism and developmental disabilities are a spectrum, right? They look so different in everybody, and every family really has a different experience with it. But really, it all starts with naming the issue. And I think in many ways, that can be a really great thing for some families to finally identify it. And in other ways, it can be a really heartbreaking thing. I was saying I had to sort of mourn the dream of, or the death of the dream of the daughter I thought I would have. And, you know, I don't know if many of you can relate to that, but when you're pregnant and then you have babies and you just imagine, right? Like no one ever imagines special needs. You just imagine a life of them growing up together. And I had all my kids really close together. My first 2 are 15 months apart. My second 2 are 2 years apart. And I did that on purpose because I thought, oh, I want them close together to be really good friends. They'll go to the same schools. And, you know, yes, a whole different kind of grief follows with the type of diagnosis for your child. I agree with that. So it is really hard. And I think then there's these other things that happen that, you know, particularly clinicians or people who don't live in our shoes don't understand, like dealing with the dynamics. How do you tell, extended family, right? Like, you know, my own experience, my parents were really supportive and really caring and heartbroken for me to see me have to go through what future struggles were unknown, but they knew it would be a little bit harder. My ex's family, I am divorced, and unfortunately that's also often, you know, something that happens when you have families living with special needs. It wasn't because of her diagnosis, but it was sort of the straw that broke the camel's back for a marriage that might have had some fragments in it. And so that side of the family had a totally different reaction. And my ex sort of went into denial. And when he finally did tell his family, his mom, who happens to be a speech therapist of deaf adults, looked at me and said, "Well, Amy, you know, autism has got to be from your side of the family because we don't have it." And that is not the thing that I wanted to hear, right? I think, you know, you can see in the last bullet point is about the feelings of isolation and guilt and anger, and then sometimes relief for some families to say, this is why Joey was so quirky, or this is why he has trouble doing this, right? For me, it was totally out of the blue. Annie was young, like 15 months when we started noticing. And so I think, you know, I didn't know anything about autism. This was back in 2004. So it was, you know, Rain Man was my only reference. And so it was really pretty tricky. I see a question. How do you explain to outsiders when they ask questions? Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. So first of all, I want to start by saying I couldn't say my daughter has autism and, you know, for probably 4 years without crying. It was just really hard for me. And it wasn't that I was disappointed in her or ashamed of her. It was just, I didn't know what it was. And my big thing was, I thought, does it hurt for her to have autism? I didn't know what it meant. You know, how does it feel? All I knew was those four words, "your daughter has autism," for me changed in a split second how I related to my daughter. I realized she and I didn't relate to the same way that I thought we were, right? Like, she understood the world in a very different way. And I totally felt the obligation to immediately try and understand what she's going through so that I could help her interpret the world and the world kind of relate to her better. So it is hard. And we can talk about some ways that you do it. I think sometimes you just don't have to say anything. You just ignore it. Now Annie is almost 20. So this is, you know, 18 years later. I now am very much about awareness, and you'll see some of the things that she does that are still sort of quirky, but they call attention to her, right? Because she now looks like a young woman. And so she doesn't act her age in many ways. She has the mentality of like a 3 to 5 year old. You know, she still can't cross a street by herself, and she still needs help showering and those kinds of things. So, but in other ways, then, you know, she is a young lady. And I think it's hard to explain it. I think for the people who care about you in your life, for me, this was sort of a weed setter. It really showed me the people who accept us and care for me. And then the people who just didn't get it, I honestly didn't have the time to try and make it with them. So thanks for sharing, Bonnie. So there's my cute baby Annie, right? Rosy and pink and just looks perfect. And so it was completely shocking when I got this diagnosis. There's things that that happen that if you don't live it, you really don't understand it. So this personal grieving process is very real. And if you're familiar with that Kubler-Ross cycle of grief, you know, you can go through anger and, you want to change, like trade, you'd offer yourself instead of your child. So it's bartering. You can have, you know, then sadness and depression. And then hopefully at the end of this is acceptance. And I work with so many families that, you know, are close to acceptance, but they've not really reached that. And, you know, if I had that magic solution of how you reach acceptance, I'd be rich and we would all have good answers. But I think it's totally a process of really learning how to embrace your child or adult and you know, really like hone into those silver lining moments, which we're going to talk about. After that diagnosis, at least for me, it was total information overload. I had no idea of what to do. They were like, you need these specialists, right? Developmental behavioral pediatrician. You need a neurologist, a gastroenterologist, speech therapy, physical therapy, all these things that I just totally didn't understand. And so that was overloading. And then there's the land of acronyms, right? Don't we all, if you've been here for a while, you speak in acronyms, ABA, Applied Behavior Analysis, PT, Physical Therapy, IEP, Individualized Education Plan. So many, many things that I think, let's see, you have to acceptance, experience, the cycle of grief, missed milestones. Yeah, that's very true. We'll talk about that too. So I think, you know, those acronyms just make it more confusing and intimidating. And you have now double work because you have to figure that out. Plus you have to access, you know, the therapies or specialists they're requesting. I think, like I mentioned in my story about sharing with, you know, my ex's family, sometimes telling family is not an easy thing. I often hear families that I work with talk about that the families will say, the extended families will say, oh no, he just needs more time. Or I think you're being overly, you know, protective. I don't think the doctor has the right diagnosis. And that makes it hard because you're already challenged as the parent trying to grip this, right? And then to have people, I know they're trying to be hopeful and I think intentions are good, but I think it makes it really, really difficult. Worries about the future. So the day that my daughter got the diagnosis, my first worry, and I'm sure many of you can relate to this, but what happens when I die? Number one, and I probably think about that every day, even though I have done every single thing I can for future planning for her up till this point in her life, it doesn't matter because us as caregivers, you know, you give the best care to your child or adult that you can, and no one ever can replace you. And then there's all the little things in between, right? So these are the milestones that you're right, that we can miss out on. So potty training, my daughter didn't get potty trained till she was 10. That was 10 long years. And I'm talking like messy fecal smearing and everything that you can imagine. Not because she was trying to be naughty. It was because she didn't understand, right? And she was sort of learning about herself. And I see a comment in there telling me my son was fine. He was just developing at his own pace. And I do think that they do develop at their own pace, but they have developmental delays. So I've seen my daughter get to things, but much later than what a typical child would get. I think then worrying about the future. So you're worrying about schools and transitioning, what's appropriate. My daughter goes to an approved private school. Does anybody not know what that is? You can raise your hand if you don't know. And for those of you that don't have your cameras on, if you want to put your cameras on, I would love it. Okay, let me explain. I see. Thank you for raising your hand. I don't care what you look like today. I would rather see your faces and we can all kind of be in this together. So put it on. Enjoy us. This is going to be interactive. And I'm reading the text now, but we're going to go ahead and we're going to have some conversation too. So an approved private school is a school that is funded through your state and your local township and your school district, but it's for her, in Annie's case, it is a specialized school for kids with autism. So they have basically a 2-to-1 staff to student ratio. So these are really intensive kids. Oh my goodness, Melissa, don't worry about it. Poor Melissa she's in the hospital. I'm sorry, Melissa, to hear that. You hop off at any moment in time. So, you know, I think that it's important that you are aware that these schools are there. So for Annie, she has a school that's very intensive for behavioral issues and one-to-one learning. That's called an approved private school. We know that there's very specific courses in public schools or classes in public schools, like an autistic support class or emotional behavior class or those kinds of things. So it all depends on where your child is, but even though that is difficult to find, and then transitioning, you know, what happens when you go from preschool to elementary and elementary to middle and middle to high school. And, you know, I'm not letting Annie graduate. There is no graduation for her. She's not going to get a diploma. She needs to be in the school system until she's 21 to maximize the services. Because really at age 21, we call that the cliff, And that's because really everything that you're entitled to, so all of that federal Department of Ed funding that you're entitled to is gone. There's no longer entitlement. You have to try and access things. And it's based on where you are with your disability. And it's just so incredibly difficult to access. So I think it's totally dealing with a new reality and lifestyle that nobody really expects. I don't think any of us are prepared for that. I see in rural areas, yeah, it's really hard to find services. You are absolutely right. I would like to tell you, if you are interested, there is a program called ECHO Autism. So it's ECHO Autism. I actually will put it in the chat. ECHO Autism is an incredible thing. I actually serve as a family hub member, but what it is, oh, I see somebody knows about ECHO. That's great. So ECHO Autism is, I think you can go to echoautism.org, and they offer, basically it's access to professionals where you meet virtually, and it's about an hour or an hour and a half. There's a new one for family ECHO Autism. So you can join that. It's all other parents with professionals. One of the doctors that I work with at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia is a participant in it. It is totally virtual. It's free, and you just have to make time for it, and you can get more information there. So it's not a one-to-one though. They really, so that what we talk about is not offering PHI, personal health information, right? Because we don't want to give up those HIPAA rules, and that's required. It is nationwide, but there's different hospitals. So at CHOP, I'm a family partner at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. I work on their ECHO Autism, but it's geared more toward professionals. So pediatricians who don't know a lot about autism, or psychologists or neurologists that want to learn more. There's a new one that is geared toward families, and it's based out of nationwide Children's Hospital. I am happy to, once I can access my email, I will put the link in the box, or I can follow up. And yes, the ECHO Family Advocates is the one that I'm talking about. There's that, and there's also kind of more one for beginner families that are just getting used to this. So that's one great thing. All right. So let me give you another. I'm going to, you know, this story is going to be a lot about videos and sort of our journey. And I want you to kind of, I'm hoping that you'll appreciate the journey that I've been on with my own daughter, and that you'll be able to take away some of these things for yourself, your own family, or the families that you work with. So let me just switch my screen for one more video. And if someone doesn't see the video, I'd like you to go off mute, because my screen goes away when I show you this. But if you can go off mute and just tell me it's not working, that'd be great. And then I'll fix it. All right, let's see. Where is it? Here we go. All right, that's a lovely pose of me. Can everybody see that? Someone say yes if you can see it. Anybody? Oh, thank you. Thank you. Okay. I know I hate this face when it starts, but let's take a look.
I'm a mom to three kids, Danny, Annie, and Ryan Kelly. Annie's 14, Ryan is 11, and Annie's 13, and my daughter who has autism. It wasn't until she was probably about a year when I realized she didn't really laugh very easily. She didn't make eye contact very easily. I had no idea that it would end up being autism. When I had her assessed, it turned out to be global developmental delays. And I just said, what are global developmental delays? And they said, that's delays in every area. They gave me sort of a week to look at the top 10 signs of what, you know, the red flags are. And I remember staring at the computer screen and saying, oh, thank God, it's not autism, because she only has 9 of those. Then I needed to go see a developmental pediatrician, and they knew right away it was autism. I can see it now, I just didn't see it then. The best thing anyone ever said to me when Annie was diagnosed, she will change, she will grow, and she will get better and do better.
Get your coat. Yeah, first coat, then backpack.
I realized I was the only person that could really do anything for Annie. it was either I help her or she doesn't get help. But I just continued along with trying to figure out what to do for Annie, which basically consisted of teaching her a means of communication and applied behavior analysis and starting a home program, trying to get her integrated into the community. I couldn't go to the grocery store. I couldn't go, you know, anywhere with her. It was only through lots and lots of supports and therapy that did we start to make some progress.
So Annie didn't learn to talk till she was 10, really, or start trying to talk till she was 10, which was amazing because they said if she didn't talk by the time she was five, she probably would not talk.
She's really one of my heroes. She's come so far since her diagnosis and in ways that I just couldn't have imagined. She really enjoys her family. She's very loving. She loves being outside. She loves music. She loves cooking. And she's just very in sync with her family and people close to her. Actually, she just learned how to blow her nose. She's 13 now, but she's so proud of herself that she can blow her nose on her own. And so that's all she's trying to do, but it's a huge deal. It's really hard to teach someone to blow their nose. I would tell every family never to lose hope and never go by what the statistics say. And this is your child and you need to believe in them. And you just don't know what they're gonna do. They're capable of so much. And we have to remember that as their parents. We have to believe in that.
So we have a song that we've been singing since Annie was about one. And we'll see if she'll fill in the blanks. I'm not a singer. Ready? Why do
they
suddenly appear
every time you are by me?
Me.
Just like
me.
They long to
be
close to you. Why do
so
fall down from the
sky?
Great job.
All right, so hold on, let me get out of this really quick. I just have to say, I just love that girl. Screen sharing has stopped. Hang on, let me just go ahead and share the other one. So I'm so proud of my daughter. And that was a while ago, but you know, that was her first, the first time she was, that's our song that we've sang since she was teeny tiny. And for her who has such trouble speaking, what a big deal for her to, you know, do that. Of course, the first time we are on, you know, TV or being recorded, she messes up. She never does that, but whatever. That's just part of life, right? Okay. So hold on. Let me just get you guys over here. Are we back to the screen? Everybody can see the screen with the presentation? All right. Okay. The rest of them are embedded, so we should be fine. Let me ask, are there any questions up till this point right now that I haven't answered? Thank you for saying she's beautiful. I think that she is as well, but let me know if there's any questions. And you're welcome to come off mute. Otherwise, we'll keep on chugging. All right. So, you know, after a diagnosis, really, there's no longer a lot of family privacy. And it's for many reasons. One, if you have, you know, services in your home, which we have, there's something called wraparound services in Pennsylvania where I am, but a lot of states have this sort of thing, but there are services where people come in to work with your child or your family. It's pretty invasive and it just doesn't feel like what you plan for in your life. You didn't expect to be having people in your home all the time. And if you have a child that goes to a specialized class, you have to talk with the teachers about that, right? And typically you understand that you have to disclose that to the teachers. You have to pretty much disclose, like when I was going through a divorce, because it really affected Annie's, you know, temperament and how she was. So all of these private things start to come out. And so, you know, as a provider, I think it's really important we remember that and we really respect that. And, you know, it's really a vulnerable place for our families. Families are trusting you. They're tired and burned out. We live, you know, with our child 24/7. So there really isn't a break. And so I've heard many providers kind of say, you know, that mom's so lazy, they don't want to do anything. Sometimes that's not the case. We know many of our families juggle many things, right? That might not be their only child with special needs. They might be caregiving for their elder parents. They might have their own mental health conditions. They might be going through a divorce. They might be struggling just to keep food on the table, right? We don't really know the circumstances. So I think it's really important when you're working with families that you kind of keep this in the back of your mind, that you're not really going to know the full picture. You're going to know what they tell you, but keep that in your mind. How many people are out there are family peer specialists? I am a trainer and a provider and a specialist. Okay. So you all know that as well. You're a family peer, but we all know it's so important. There's no judgment, right? We can't have that in this. And then the last thing that I said was families are vulnerable. They really trust you to make the right decisions, to guide them in the right direction. And, you know, I really thought every therapist that walked in our house was going to save Annie. I see peer specialists, parent support partner, family specialists. It's called lots of things, but it's all the same kind of thing. I love that. So you're right. I think we have to be building the bridge to form that trust and then to recognize that our families are vulnerable and they need us. All right, let me go to the next slide. So I always state whenever I do any training as a provider, it is such an honor and a privilege that a family chooses you. They are trusting you. They're trusting your organization. We have to honor and respect that and not violate any kind of, you know, ethical boundaries. I just feel like that is such a privilege to work with their family and their child. Again, they're looking for you for trust and help. And, you know, I think what's hard, at least what was hard for me at the beginning of getting services was that I really thought that help would come overnight, like things would change overnight or, you know, from therapy. So when Annie was diagnosed, it was the day before she turned two and 3 weeks before my youngest son was born. So a really hard, hard time. Big and pregnant and really emotional and just overwhelming. The focus at that time, and again, this was back in 2004, but we didn't know that much about autism with girls. And I think, you know, there were all the different classifications and we had less knowledge. But the focus at that time for me was I want her to speak, right? That was what I thought was most important was her speaking. Deb, I see your hand is up in the audience. Do you have a question? You can come off mute if you have a question. And otherwise, if your hand's just accidentally up, that's okay. All right, maybe you can't hear me. Anyway, I'll go on, but if you have a question, just feel free to interrupt. So I think for me, it's really important for those of us that work with families, and if you're a family new coming into this, that you remember that it's slow and steady that wins the race. It's change doesn't happen overnight. So here is my Annie when she first started to learn to talk to me using PECS. Does everybody know what PECS is? Picture Exchange Communication System. Okay, so PECS is pretty amazing. My daughter didn't have the fine motor skills to do sign language, and she turned out to be very visual. So what we did was you can see there's this yellow binder in the front, and it has these little things we call icons. They're little Velcro stickers, and they have simple phrases on them like I want, which is called a sentence starter. And then she has a selection of things. So it's based off first, it's based off of preferences. And then over time, once they understand the system, you start to include more things that may not be preferred, but could be conversational and that sort of thing. PECS is a great system. And you can look that up. Let me put it in here. So Picture Exchange Communication System. And it was originally developed by a group called Pyramid. But it also can be used for stroke victims, people with traumatic brain injury, anybody that sort of needs a little bit more assistance and can respond to this. It's a pretty simple way. But what it did was gave her a voice when she didn't have one because of her verbal apraxia. Who does not know? Raise your hand if you don't know what verbal apraxia is. expect. Okay, good. We always want to ask these things. So verbal apraxia is a speech disorder. Does not always just happen with kids with autism, although there's a high rate of it co-occurring with autism, but it can be a typical child who has, a verbal apraxia diagnosis. It's the part of your brain that actually controls the way your mouth moves. And there's sort of this disconnect between that neurologically. So Annie has all these words up in her head, but can't make her mouth move in the right way to say them. And so you'll start seeing, you could hear it a little bit in her singing with me, right? Like you saw that was a little bit hard. She also speaks very monotone. She can't do inflection in her voice, except for one thing that I'll be showing you. But it's really tricky for her. Bonnie, do you have a question? Oh, it's okay. Your hand. Oh yeah, go for it.
With my, I'm wondering if the verbal apraxia is similar to what I'm with my son. It's not so much that he can't get his mouth to move as much as when he's trying to say something, it's like he can't get the right word.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's similar.
Some of that can be processing issues and different kinds of like understanding speech versus giving speech is also very different. So like pragmatically, speech therapist is the one that would really identify that. And when your kids are peanuts and little, it's really hard to tell if it's verbal apraxia or the autism. As they get bigger, it's a little bit easier to tease that out. But I would say you definitely want to ask a speech therapist about that, because that is something else that would be treated in a different way that could really help facilitate communication. But the amazing thing what PEX did was Annie started learning words from rote memory, right? Because it has a picture of something and then the word below it. And over time, she started memorizing these words. And so she eventually moved to PEX on her iPad, and she could start to, so they have several programs that look like this PEX binder, but are on the iPad. She uses something called Proloquo to go. And I'll put that in, but there's a gazillion now. This was like one of the only ones that they had then. And it's the one that Annie knows the best. Proloquo to go. But there's many of them now, and they're all fantastic. And if you generally you start with a very simple way with a binder, and then you move to the electronic way. But what this also did was then she started getting interested in learning how to read and write and spell. And they told me she would never do those things. And I will tell you, this girl is on her iPad Googling stuff and listening to music and texting me. She'll text me when I'm sitting on the couch. She'll text me from her bedroom at 5:30 in the morning when I'm trying to sleep, which is so funny. I mean, I gotta laugh. She's just such a delight. But I want to show you her now. This is an example, and you'll hear some of the apraxia here and some of the challenges. It's hard for her to enunciate, but here she is.
Yes, I am. Serious? Tell me. You are what? Hey. What are you? You're serious?
No.
No? Are you hilarious? Let me hear. Okay.
No more
hilarious.
No.
All right. So she just cracks me up. So she was telling me before I videoed that she's hilarious. Now, I'll tell you a couple things. One, she's smelling. Those are perfume papers, the kind you get in like the Kohl's ads or in the magazines. We figured out very long time ago that she is such a sensory person, right? And so she loves water play and rice bins and that sort of thing. She also loves perfume. She's very much a girly girl. She loves lip gloss and perfume. And I have people, and you guys are welcome to send it to me. I'll put my address in, but if you collect these for me, we love them. I have people sending these from all over the country to me now, but it's so cool. She loves to smell them. And then she sits there and she shreds them into little pieces and plays with them. But you know what that's like? That is like someone knitting or like someone tapping a pencil or moving their leg. It's a little bit of a stim, but it's self-soothing. And it allows her to hang out in the same room as my husband and I and her brothers and watch TV together or be around each other. It gives her enough of a calming thing. So if you have a child that might be interested in that, the one thing I would caution you is if you teach shredding, be prepared that they might try it with books, or she's done it with books, with money. I said to her school, okay, generalization for this is not good. We don't want to apply it. She ripped up a $20 bill and I was like, no, we can't do that. So, but really cool that she has that. So that's what she was doing there. You can see total typical 19-year-old putting her headphones on, like, I'm all done talking to you, mom, which is funny. You could hear some of the trouble with her enunciating, right? Like, I can understand her pretty well, but if you were here and I said, what are you doing? She would type it out for you and say serious or hilarious, or I'm done talking about it or whatever. Thank you. I see. I love her personality, and she is full of personality. You'll continue to see that. Jackie, I see you have a question about menstruation, and I'm happy to talk about that. I'm going to go through it a little bit more so we progress with her age. I kind of have it in that way. And for those of you that can stomach it, I think, you know, talking about menstruation and puberty and development is a really important thing. Many people are afraid to ask their doctors about it or uncomfortable talking about it. But the problem is, if we don't talk about it, then we can't help them in the right way. So I think it's really important we do that. So I'll go back on. Okay. So I think that as professionals in the field, as clinicians, it is our responsibility to give care across for the whole family. So autism is maybe an individual diagnosis, but it truly is a family diagnosis. And it's really important for those of you that are family peer support specialists, you understand we have to meet the family where they are. We can't be pushing them too much. We want to give them things to accomplish, right? Some goals that we identify together. But we want to help them to learn slowly. Not every parent is going to be a super advocate right away, right? And they're not all going to, that's right, their race, their pace. I love that. I haven't heard it that said that way. I love that. We want to teach the family how to implement some of your tricks. If you're the one, like if you are that support person working with their child and you know, hey, Annie really loves perfume papers. Why don't you try that at home to see if it helps her calm down? We want to be sharing those things with them. And we also don't want to forget that every moment is a teaching moment. And I think sometimes, you know, I know for me, at least as a parent, I was exhausted all the time, and I was learning how to like be enthusiastic and give 5-to-1 reinforcement versus like negative statements, right? Like those are all things you have to build in, but it's exhausting and it's hard to learn. And so here I have a picture, you know, there's my baby Ryan, who I call my angel baby. He was the one that was born 3 weeks after Annie's diagnosis, but he sort of saved me in that very sad time in my life. He hit every milestone just ahead of time. Now, having a daughter just diagnosed, and we know that autism is more prevalent in boys, almost 4-to-1, boys to girls. So I thought for sure, since I had this baby boy, I was like, he's got to probably be on the spectrum if I just had a daughter diagnosed, right? So it's a rule out disorder. They don't know that you can't do a blood test or whatever. It's based on how they're developing. And so the fact that he was meeting every milestone early was just sort of this peacefulness that I really needed. But I was on guard for 3 years until he was 36 months to really be able to rule that out. But I was blowing these bubbles. These are those cheap bubbles that kind of last and they sit on the surface for a little. They do leave a little film, but they're kind of good if you're trying to get them to look at the bubbles and see them. And all I wanted Annie to do was either point or try and pop one or say, puh, puh, you know, or buh, something to try and sound it out. And I just couldn't even get her to pay attention. This guy in the back is my dad, who we call Pop, and is Annie's favorite person in the whole world. They're very close. And there's my naughty Danny. He was 3, sticking something into the VCR, just like a 3-year-old should, I guess, right? All right. So here's another great video. you know, all these little videos I'm showing you. So the other two were a little more professional, but I have a whole bunch of from my family. These are just from my iPhone or my cell phone at the time. And we weren't doing it. I wasn't even in the field for much of this. It was more about tracking Annie's progress and understanding so I could share with therapists and that sort of thing. But we know, you know, those of you who are families know that sometimes these little things in life are big things. So to set this up, Annie was, I think she was probably 8 or 10 here, and she had to really start taking her medications with a pill because she was getting too big to take liquid form, and some of them didn't come in liquid form. And teaching a kid to swallow can be very challenging. It's a really hard thing to do. So I'm lucky that I work with all these great, you know, doctors and clinicians. And so they sent me this really formal protocol on how to teach pill swallowing. And I was like, gosh, this is really complex. You know, I don't know. I'm going to start with this. I'm going to try and start with her brothers and see if they can model for her using little M&Ms, mini M&Ms, if they can swallow the M&Ms and show her. For Annie, I did not give her an M&M. I gave her an adult aspirin because I didn't want her to think medicine is candy, first of all. And I wanted it to taste bad if it sat in her mouth, right? So that's one thing I would caution you if you're kind of trying to train. You got to think ahead because we don't want the candy-like things to be taken as if it's medicine. So here is the video. I'm going to also tell you that baby brother Ryan, who's probably, so if Annie's 10, he was 8, or maybe she's 8 and he's 6. It's going to feel like we're on a cruise for a minute because it's a little unstable. He was filming it, but it'll all pan out. No getting seasick.
Water.
Swallow.
Good. Did you do it?
Ooh,
one more time. One more time.
Swallow the pill.
Swallow the pill.
It'll come
back up. You can do it. Swallow the whole thing. Oh, baby girl. Yes, I know. Put that back in your mouth. Let's try it again. So, no, that's a pill. You need to swallow it. Hold. Ready? Go. Go.
Swallow. Like, swallow the water.
Did you do it? All done?
No.
No, you got to do it all done. 1, 2, 3. Swallow.
She needs the water?
Yeah.
Good brother, right?
Slow. 1, 2, 3. Annie, swallow. All the way. Is it all gone?
Go.
Let me see. Yeah!
Annie.
Good job!
So, if you had paid attention, she tapped me like, yo, mom, I already swallowed the pill. And meanwhile, I'm like frenzied trying to get my water and be prepared. But here, she did it. And I'll tell you still, every night, so it's probably been almost 10 years, she still shows us when she takes her melatonin at night, and we all have to ooh and ah. But honestly, that's such a small price to pay. If that makes her feel confident, I don't care. That girl will take any pill we need. She'll take any medicine we need. She's so cooperative. It's well worth it, right? All right. So teaching, those are called natural supports. Natural supports are your family or friends or community that you're close to who can help you demonstrate these things. So for her, her brothers are big natural supports for her. And we want to make sure that families are aware. Uh-oh, is anybody having trouble hearing me?
It just got really soft and then it got really loud again, but
okay.
It's better now.
Ah, strange. Okay. Keep me posted with that. So did you catch the natural supports part? Okay. And then helping families find a support system. And again, that may not always be family, right? That could be a church group. It could be an online support group. That's what I did at the beginning because I had 3 little babies and no time to go to meetings. But at night, after I got them tucked in, I could check an online support group, ask questions, and do it at my own pace. There's formalized support groups, neighbors, whatever it looks like, but we want to try and make sure we as families or we working with families can connect them to resources. Again, meeting the family where they are, encouraging the family's participation in therapy or advocacy, whatever it is, but to the extent that they can. Even it could just be making time for the siblings. I found that to be such a challenge and such it was such guilt I had that I would, Annie required so much attention. It wasn't like I was trying to ignore her brothers, but I had to set up date times with her brothers, separate date times, so they got one-on-one time with me, because Annie still is eyes on 24/7. You know, we have to make sure she's safe. Safety's number one. Her brothers really understand that, and they weren't, you know, resentful of that, but it was, I was the one that was worried about it. How many people out there do struggle with sibling things right now, or have in the past? Yeah, it is very common. Have you heard of sib shops? Anybody heard of sib shops? Okay, let me type this in the chat box. It is a brand name, but it is a method. I'm actually a sib shop trainer, and you all could become one too. You have to go through a training. Yay, I see someone's providing sib shops. It was the greatest thing I gave to my boys. What it is basically it's set up like a play date. Usually they tend to be for ages 7 to 12, maybe 5 to 13. It depends. But it's set up like a play date for maybe 2 hours. You usually have a trained therapist do it, or a psychologist can do it. And there's structure to it where they have sort of an icebreaker and they make it fun. Oh, no problem, Lonnie. Goodbye. See ya. They have, they make it fun. You get a snack, but you're there with other siblings of kids with disabilities, and a skilled sib shop trainer starts to get them to talk about it. So, you know, what does your sister do, Danny? I remember, so Danny and Ryan would go together, and Ryan was a bit younger. He's about 3.5 years younger than Danny, but they were good buddies together. The first one though, Danny, my older son, went to, he came out and he's like, Mom, guess what? I met this girl and she has a brother who has Down syndrome and they can't go to restaurants either. And it was like so rewarding to him. And we know many of us go through isolation during the diagnosis, or even just living in this world of therapy and constant, you know, advocacy. There's often not a lot of people who relate to that. Our kids go through the same thing. The siblings go through the same feelings, just in their own version. So sib shops is a great way to help them start to process the diagnosis too, and to feel included and like they have, you know, something for themselves. Assisting the family with asking for help. That was my number one thing that was so hard for me. I just assumed as a mom that I was supposed to do everything and know everything for my kids. Many of us feel like that. I'm sure many fathers feel like that. And I had to break down and finally ask, like, I could not get to the grocery store, or I couldn't do our laundry. We lived in a messy house for many years, and I would have to ask a neighbor, can you drop off a pizza? I just can't get out of the house. For me to get out of the house, it was Annie had to, you know, be in a double stroller, as well as Ryan. And Danny had to be holding on to this little rope with a loop on it. So it was like 2 feet from the stroller, so he wouldn't wander off, right? Because they were so little, it was just impossible. So I think encouraging our families and letting them know that it's not a sign of weakness, it's actually a strength to ask for help, and recognizing that, right? And then recognizing these gifts when you don't expect them. And I call them silver linings in here, but you know, sometimes life seems so chaotic and you just can't recognize the great things that come from it. So I'm going to show you more of our great things. You've seen some of them so far, but I'm going to show you a couple other things. So here's a video that was done about our family for a local newspaper. This was before I was in the profession at my organization. This was sort of a follow-up story. They had interviewed us probably 4 years before that. And so they wanted to check in with us and follow up in our paper. So here's the video. Pay attention, because there's a little quiz at the end to see if you can guess what Annie's thinking. Let me climb up.
10-year-old Annie Kelly was diagnosed with autism the day before her second birthday. She lives with her older brother, Danny Kelly, her mother, Amy Kelly, and her younger brother, Ryan Kelly. While she only just started saying a few words about a year and a half ago, she uses a picture exchange communication system to express her needs.
Do you want ice cream? Or like this? Or if she wants a waffle. She can just ask, I want waffle.
And then what does she do?
And then she comes up to mom or one of us.
And she gives it to Danny. And she points.
She points and says, I want waffle. And I say it after.
You say it out loud. She can't say it.
Yeah,
she
can't say it.
So she
wants to see how you do it.
You tell me.
So you can hear her. That's her apraxia. I want.
Are we missing the picture? Where? Popcorn. What do you want? Let me see.
Okay. So I'm so glad. This video, unfortunately, wouldn't download anymore, but I'm very relieved it wouldn't, because guess what she said? I'll tell you why I didn't want it to download. She formed a sentence strip, and this is what it said. It said, I want, and she put the song, You Are My Sunshine, and then the word chips. What do you think she wanted? You can go off mute.
Wow. Sun chips.
Yes, exactly.
That was amazing.
Oh, and I freaked out just like this. And I was like, we're going to the store and she gets every flavor, right? Like reinforce that. How awesome. She came up with a word that she didn't even have in her book and she knew what she wanted. How creative, right? So it's our job as parents, as clinicians, to watch our guys are communicating with us, guys and gals are communicating with us all the time. And if we don't pick up on that, that's on us, right? That's on us totally. So I was like, man, she is just so cool. And I was just blown away. And she has done stuff like this throughout her life. Here's more of our silver lining moments and our happy moments. This is me and Annie dressed up as witches. She hated my wig and I tried to put one on her and she refused. This down here was Annie's 15th birthday. And you know what she wanted for her birthday? We call these babies. It's all the Sesame Street characters. And now every stuffed animal is called a baby. But I will tell you, this is the first time that my daughter wanted to play with babies. And so it wasn't at 1.5 or 2 years old, but it was no less special than being at 15 years old, right? She just got there on her own time. And that's what I mean by they do get there on their own time. You can't be irresponsible about missing a diagnosis or delaying services, but we have to be patient with our guys to really develop in their own way. This was Annie's birthday the other year with our family around. This is Danny, her big brother, and her doing pimple masks because they all go through puberty at the same time. And then I'm going to show you this little video. So you heard a little bit Annie in that video where she was talking when she said, eh. So we called that her happy sound. And Annie, so you're going to hear the real happy sound. She didn't know I was videoing this because I didn't want to throw her off. But this is what my house sounds like when we know Annie's happy. And we all love it. It fills our hearts with joy. So she's talking to Elmo. She's so happy. She will do this in restaurants. She scared the crap out of somebody at the mall the other day. Oh, poor woman jumped. And I was like, oh, this is autism happy sounds. And she was like, oh my gosh, I thought something was wrong, right? So I use these opportunities for awareness, but you know, knowing what makes that individual happy is really important. You see here, I have Annie closed door here. We're working on privacy. We have notes everywhere. We close our door when we change. These are hard things. So as we're getting into adolescence and through puberty and menstruation, she's not aware. I will tell a funny story and hopefully you guys will appreciate it. But her brother, Danny, who's the one down here, was coming up the stairs when, you know, she was many years ago, but he was probably 15 and she was probably 14 or something like that. And there's Annie standing at the stairs, butt naked. And now she is a full grown lady, right? And Danny's like, Mom, my first exposure to a naked girl and it's my sister. I'm never going to view things the same, right? Like, and I was like, buddy, I'm so sorry. She totally doesn't understand, right? And so we've really had to work on privacy, and those are major concerns. I will say, so let me go on to the next slide. I think I have one more. We'll take a second here. So I'll talk about, because there was a question specifically about menstruation. And for those of you that have girls, that's an intimidating time, I think, in life. I will tell you, I was at work when Annie's school nurse called and said, Annie's fine. I just wanted to let you know she got her period. And I broke down crying because it to me, it meant several things. One, she was like moving into womanhood. Two was if she ever got raped, she could get pregnant. And I will tell you, abuse is at the top of my mind all the time. Protecting our individuals who don't have that verbal ability is so key. All of our individuals, wherever they are on the spectrum or with disabilities, are subject to being violated more, but particularly those that don't have language. So that is something that you should be aware of as a parent or a provider. You have to have the ultimate kind of guard up to be checking on them. So Annie got her first period. I thought, okay, I actually did pad training. I recommend this to all moms. I did pad training for 2 years with her prior. I wasn't sure when she was going to get it, but around 11 or 12. 23. I always have my guard up too, Beverly. We did pad training, just simple panty liner in her underwear just to make sure she was getting the feel of it, 1 week a month for 2 years. When she gets her period, obviously she needs a much thicker pad. And I was like, I don't know how she's going to handle this. So I ended up putting the pad on for nighttime. And then I put on one of those like Depends undergarments, the larger kind of pull-ups for adults for incontinence. And so I thought, okay, she'll totally be protected. And now I told you that we've been through fecal smearing when she was younger. So poop smearing and just interest in that kind of thing. Well, the next morning I go into Annie's room and I'm walking and she had like laminate floors and I feel like sand on the floor. And I was like, we weren't at the beach. I don't understand. And then I look and that girl had, I think she did not appreciate the Depends because she ripped it off. And inside of that is a desiccant to absorb everything. She had shredded that. And that's what the sand stuff was everywhere. And she did shred her pad, unfortunately. That was the only time she did it though. We talked about it. She's becoming more mature. I said, this means that you're a woman. You have to be careful with it because it's dirty. We have to wash our hands. And I meant dirty, not in a bad thing getting your period, but in a, you don't want to touch it that way. We do it in the bathroom. And we had visual resources, like a visual chart to show the order of how to do it. There's a great book that's out there, and there's probably much newer ones, but there's one called Aaron's Period, written by a woman in my area with her daughter named Aaron, and she did that to try and help her daughter. It's almost like a social story, but how to learn about how to handle that. So it's something, if you have a daughter, you definitely want to be aware of and prepared for and try and start talking about it with them early, regardless of where they are with their intellectual and cognitive ability. They still need to understand that. So, I didn't cover this. We already talked about person first and versus identity first. I always defer to person first language unless the person specifically says I'm autistic or I prefer to be called that way. I never correct parents that call their kids that way. That's their choice, right? But for me, I defer as a professional to person first. I found that there are some people who, when you have a minimally verbal or a nonverbal person, that there's some people who forget to talk to the person. Like they would only look at me. And really great doctors have done this. We'll walk in and they'll say, so mom, how's Annie doing? And Annie's right next to me. And I'll say, Annie, how you doing? Tell Dr. So-and-so, right? So I think it's really important that we don't forget that they understand and that they're there. So I want our doctors to be looking at them and to be saying, hey, Annie, how you doing? And then look at mom to kind of get the picture if we need help with that. And always just remembering that you're a team. Without a partnership, it's really hard to make progress, to have optimal outcomes, and to get buy-in for the family if you're working with services with them. So I think it goes to building the trust. So mental model, we all kind of have grown up with our own past histories and experiences, maybe our own trauma, your own culture. And it's important to be aware of all of these things when you're working with families so that you understand what your messages come out as and sound like to the families you're working with, just knowing where you are. So, you know, at Devereux, we have a lot of very traumatized individuals that come to us who don't trust systems of care and don't trust professionals. And it's really important that our staff understand that. But they also recognize, you know, if they relate to a trauma that someone has gone through, that they're able to step back and talk to their supervisor to say, you know, this is triggering for me. I need to, you know, probably work with a different individual during this time. I'm having a hard time. Talking in a strengths-based way is so important. So really starting off with, you know, so tell me what's good. What's going on that's good? What has happened, right? We've been talking about all these little things that Annie's done. Those are great examples of little things that families might not recognize that we need to help them recognize. Let's start with that. And then we can talk about challenges, not problems. They're challenges. They're temporary. We can help them through it. But we have to, I really think, and this is not rose-colored glasses, but this is a way to position things so families start seeing these as things that we can conquer, right? They're not impossible mountains. Like, we can do this. There's my little kiddos from Halloween. Like, you can see a little this is little baby Ryan. There's little baby Ryan. So this was about 10 years apart. Now, little Ryan and big Danny are way taller than me. Everybody's taller than me too. But I think it's fun to kind of look back and see where they've come. So we all know it sounds like on this call, nothing about us without us. That goes for both of the individuals who we help and we're caring for, as well as the family. So think about it. If you are in the field and you don't have a loved one with a disability, but if you go to the doctor and the doctor says, well, here, I'm going to give you heart surgery. I think you want to be part of that decision, right? Like, you don't want to just have someone tell you you're going in for heart surgery and you don't have a choice. So I think, you know, really listening to the family, listening to what their goals are and their concerns, putting those specific words into treatment plans and documentation. So I went through a really hard time with my daughter with self-injurious behavior. She was biting herself, banging her head on the wall, hitting her head with a hairbrush. It was mostly due to, transition back and forth to her dad's house during our divorce. And so it makes sense of why that was her communicating to me, like, this is not cool, mom, right? But I would say to my, you know, clinician, I need Annie to stop biting herself and hitting herself with the hairbrush. Like, it, that was one of the most heartbreaking times in my life because it was really hard to control and to change. The clinician can then write, reduce self-injurious behaviors, right? It's like, if you're on the clinical side, but we need the family's words in there to get the buy-in from them. Helping with prioritization is key because we have so many things on our plate as families that we're told to do. And I don't even know where to start. Like, I thought focusing on speech was the thing, but truly it was, I think, working on communication, not speech, right? She needed a way to just tell us, and she learned that through PEC. So helping identify that, and usually the way that I do that is to say, well, tell me what your top two, you know, important things are to the family. And then you as the clinician or the staff can say, my top two things are these two. Where can we find a ground that we agree on? And then you really want to transfer skills to the family that you're working with to connect on things. I see a question, how do you deal with providers who don't use what the parents are telling them about, yeah, their child is dealing with and the behaviors. I say, so first of all, as a parent, I would video and send it to them so that there's no disputing. I know often this can happen in school, and it's true because sometimes in school, kids act very differently and teachers don't see the same behaviors, or they may see different challenging behaviors in school that you don't see at home. I think having a video of that and then talking about it is one way. My philosophy is parents are truly the expert on their kid. There is nobody else. I don't care if it's a, you know, doctor with a gazillion PhDs. They're the expert in their field, but they're not the expert on my kid, right? And so we all need to be, I think, respectful of that part so that they understand that the family feels like they're an equal team member, an equal contributor. And that is a way that you build trust with families so that they will follow through with the things that you're trying to get them to do. I'm going to skip this part because I have a few more things and I'm cognizant of our time. So surviving daily life. And for some people, I think, Bonnie, I'll get to you in 1 minute if that's okay. You can leave your hand up. I think surviving sounds like a harsh word, but for me, it was very true. I sometimes would just have to make it to, I see Latriva, is that how you say your name? I see that you've had to send videos too. It's really tough, yeah. But for me, I couldn't go to the bathroom alone because I had all my three little kids so close together. I was just desperate to make it to the next moment. I was so overwhelmed. And so I think it's really important to help our families recognize times that have been good, things that have worked, that they're resilient. If a family is following, let's say, a schedule at home that you've asked them to do, or they're doing positive praise with their child and you've been working on that, praise that parent too, because, you know, our kids, we're used to giving our kids all the kudos, but we also need the parents to have the kudos so that they continue to do what we want them to be doing and to continue. So really you're looking for continuity of success, whether it's in the medical setting, the education setting, the community setting, or at home. And then acceptance of a new normal, and, you know, normal looks different for everybody. I'm going to show you, oops, this is my normal. And I will tell you, there is Annie at the beach sitting in a little pool. And she was probably, I guess, 13 or something here. And people were staring and like, why is that big kid sitting in the pool? This was a huge moment for me. I was a single mom. It was the very first time I could take my kids to the beach alone. And I had two requirements. One, the boys, her brothers, could outrun her in case she eloped. And two, they were strong enough to help me schlep all this stuff in the background there. And it worked out. And they came, they blew up Annie's pool. They filled it up for her. And then they could go boogie boarding. I actually got to sit on the beach for the first time as a mother with my kids, which was a miracle. And then this was just us this summer at the beach. And here, you know, Annie's too big to sit in this little pool. And actually, that's so weird. They're the exact same. It's not the same pool from that long, let me just tell you, but it's the one we buy, I guess, all the time. And here she is listening to her music on her phone, just like a typical teenager, right? I want to show you this next thing. So this is also big. This is the first year she filled up her own pool. So I want to just, this is a quick clip, and then we'll answer some questions in the text box.
More? Go ahead.
Sir.
What?
No more, sir.
No more?
Sir.
Sand? It's okay if there's a little sand. We're at the beach.
And no more, sir.
And then no more sand. Okay. You want one more time for buckets?
Yeah.
And then you can sit down and play.
Yeah.
Okay, go for it.
Listen. She just brings me such joy. Here she is at the beach doing those happy sounds. She's so proud of herself. We're so proud of her. She was a little concerned about the sand that comes in the buckets when you dump the water, but you know, she's learning. She couldn't do that before. She couldn't walk down to the water by herself without us. So huge, huge things, right? Now this is 7 years later than that first video or picture that we took, but big deal. All right, Bonnie, you've had your hand up patiently. Let's ask.
Okay, this kind of ties into the question that I had before about the providers, you know, not really taking into account what the parents are telling them. One of the challenges that I've faced over and over again with my son and the providers is because a lot of them want to say that because he's on the high functioning end of the spectrum and he is able to communicate, even though there is the diagnosis of autism, they still try to tell me that the behaviors that he's exhibiting are more choices for him and more disciplinary issues. How do I change that narrative with the providers? Because a lot of the behaviors that I'm trying to explain to them, and I've shown them on video with my son, is more of a, I don't even think he realizes that he's doing it. So it's not necessarily a discipline issue. It's more of, this is just how my son is with the autism and the other diagnoses that he has. How do I change that perspective?
Yeah, you know what? I'm going to give you my email address. Actually, I'll type it in here now. It's at the end too, but I want you to email me privately to talk specifically, but I'll just tell you something that in general, what I've seen through my experience and with all the families I've helped on the spectrum or with mental health issues, the higher functioning the kid or adolescent is, the harder it is to get services, unfortunately. So clearly Annie is very impaired. It was tough when she was little, getting her into the approved private school, but you can tell she still needs tons of help. As the kids that have more cognitive ability and more skills and can mask or cope and try and fit in better, get older, it's much harder to prove to providers and school districts that they are in need of that help. So Bonnie, I will help you specifically. I want you to send me a private email just in the sake of time. We can talk about that. Beverly, I see that you asked about what if the school says the child's headbanging is destroying property and then the referrals begin. So at Devereux, we do have a policy about, you know, we take some of the hardest individuals into residential care. We do have a policy about property destruction. And, you know, it is unfortunately very common with many of our individuals. It's part of how them working through things. It's part of their diagnosis. I think it depends on the setting where you're at. So if you're at a place that is prepared for that and equipped for that, then they can talk to you about why it's happening. They can see antecedents or what leads up to that, right? If you are in a typical school mainstream, it's going to be a shock for the school. They're probably not prepared to help you with that. So Beverly, I'm also going to offer the same thing to any of you. If you would like to email me privately to talk specifically about your case, I am more than happy to do that. I think the key thing is you as the advocate, caregiver, parent need to prepare that school and you need to be a resource for them to prepare them. If they can't handle the behaviors, then maybe that's not the right placement for your child or adult. All right, let me move on. I just have a few more. So as providers, I think, you know, this is a hard job, right? Like it is challenging emotionally. It's challenging physically. I often run into something called compassion fatigue myself. So my hard times of the year are basically like the holidays. So November through February, it's dark. I probably have a little of that seasonal affect disorder. It was the time of year when Annie was diagnosed, which was really traumatic for me and overwhelming because I just had a baby. I was unsupported by my ex, like many things going on. And so it is still sort of a triggering time of year for me. It's getting better. I'm remarried to a lovely man. We have a great family. So that helps. But I think that, you know, being aware of this as a provider is important so that you can really practice self-care. And I know we all say, yeah, exercise and sleep enough and eat enough. And it's really hard. It's hard as a parent and a caregiver. It's hard as a professional. You might be working more than one job, right? But I think as much as we can, we need to do that so that we can give the best care possible to the individuals we serve. So important thing to take away, having a family member with a disability affects every single aspect of a family's life, regardless of if they talk about it with you. Please try not to make judgments about that family, no lazy mom comments, right? Or take things personally. Often I will see families kind of lash out at providers. And frankly, it has nothing to do with the provider. It's them having a bad day. And we all have our bad days. But if you have people in your home all the time, or you're always at a center for help, it's going to come out there sometimes. And so if you're a provider or a clinician, try not to take that personally, unless, you know, you're doing something where it's very clear that it's, you know, not a good match or it's inappropriate. And then never assume you know fully what's going on in a family's life. You know, I know there's mobile therapists and psychologists and family-based therapy, but I still think families kind of hold back. Think about all of us. We probably have a little pile of dirty clothes or dirty dishes in our house, right? We're not going to talk about that. You're going to hide that if someone came over. There's all sorts of things. You're not going to tell someone necessarily if you're beginning to get separated or that kind of thing. So I think it's important to respect that and to understand that that's just part of our services. Hope is the absolute best thing that we can give our families. This I received also during a work meeting with one of our vice presidents, and I just started crying and I had to pass my phone around. But here's my Annie, who they said would never read or write or spell or anything. And here she is working. This was 2016, wearing a hairnet. This is a girl who wouldn't even like put a barrette in her hair, wearing gloves and putting those pastries in line for the senior citizen she was helping. And she didn't even eat one, which I'm shocked about because she's such a foodie. So I think it's just so important. Hope is the ultimate thing. And so all these little things should help you find hope. I had one more video from Annie's talent show, but we're gonna move on. Here's my family. This was my kids at my wedding. I got married during COVID. So that's a recent picture of them. You can see how big my guys are. And there's my special Annie. So I see lots of lovely comments. Thank you so much for listening to my story. I hope it's helpful to you all to get ideas to leave here with positive thinking, maybe some new ideas or tactics that you're going to try with your own family or with your own families that you serve. Are there any, I can stay on just a few minutes, we're at 4:59, but if there's any questions, I'm happy to have people answer them, or for me to answer them and you guys ask them, you can come off mute. Anybody?
Amy, this is Beverly. I just wanted to say thank you for sharing your lived experience.
Oh,
it's been wonderfully. Thank you for teaching us these things.
You're welcome. I hope that it's helpful, Beverly. That's my goal.
Yes, I've learned some things I'm going to take back to some families as well.
Good. That's the whole key is let's all bring something back. I hope you got at least one thing out of this. You all have, here's my email address. I am at your service. There's no charge. Just call or just send an email. We'll connect. And I hope to see you all in the future and keep in touch. Thanks for coming to this conference. The National Federation of Families is an incredible organization and we're lucky to have them with all of us caregivers. And happy National Caregiver Month. It's November. So those of you that care for people, yay you. Keep up the great work. All right. Well, no more questions. I'm gonna let us all go. Have a great evening.